everybody. That wasn't very resounding. Hello. So I'll just, thanks for being here. I'll just make a few comments and then open it up to your questions. If you heard some of or all of my comments earlier, I said, and I believe this very deeply, that what is happening here is different. There is both an energy and focus and a comprehensiveness, but also an impatience that comes, I think, from having been through these meetings before, and you hear about an announcement or you hear about this, and things don't materialize. I think the fact that almost once every 18 days you have a billion-dollar event somewhere in the world, and you have 500-year events happening now more regularly, and you see the scope of the damage, I think many more people around the world have been affected by that. And so science that for a long time scientists and people who do this professionally have been committed to. But the average folks around the world don't have time in their day, or they don't follow it every day, and they're not aware of the degree to which there's a lot of disinformation out there, purposefully being worked against the effort to secure progress on climate. And there are vested interests that resist change, and there is too much business as usual today as a result. You heard President Ruto himself say, and others, that business as usual, we just don't have the time for that. So my sense is that, and I know some of the entrepreneurs and you know, various technology entrepreneurs in climate who are here and who feel some of this excitement and have a sense that Kenya is a place where you could really make some progress rapidly and demonstrate to other people what's possible. It is quite incredible, significant, that Kenya is now at about 91% renewable, and by 2025 anticipates being at about 95%+ renewable. And they're growing. So I think that it's clear that this will be a proving and a testing ground in these next few years for what's possible. Obviously, because it's less developed nations, many of them, most of them, there's a different approach that's needed than the top 20 emitter countries and economies. But that's a different story. So on that, let me throw it open to questions. The other thing I'd add just quickly, I think this has been really productive in the context of focusing on the COP. And I've been surprised by the amount of spontaneous mentioning there has been regarding the Dubai COP in the end of November. I think that it really evidences what I was saying, that there's a anticipation for this COP because the implementation out of Glasgow has not been as strong as it should have been, and because mitigation was not as focused on in Sharm el-Sheikh as people felt it should have been. And some of the things that were promised in both places have not advanced at the pace that was promised. So I don't think a lot of interested parties around the world, NGOs, activists, companies, people struggling with their scope 1 and 2, I don't think they're going to spend a lot of time you know, being impressed by repetition of previously announced things, or by sidestepping some of the realities that we have to face about tipping points, about the dangers of where we find ourselves today. So evidence is important. What we see with our eyes is important. What we're experiencing in country after country is important here. And I don't think any amount of PR or contrived evidence is somehow going to supplant what is happening now. I feel it and see it. I've been at this a long time. I think there's more energy building to get things done than I have seen at any time that I've been involved in this. So we will see. The proof, obviously, will be in the pudding. Thank you. Can you just say who everybody is and go?
My name is Jessica Brinkmann from ARD German Television. My question is, the USA are one of the top five countries causing carbon emissions. So what do you think, how are you going to help the US and also the industrialized countries?
How are we what?
How are you going to help Africa? How do you support financially Africa?
Well, I just described today the five-year, four-year, $3 billion a year commitment President Biden has made by 2024. And so he has a year left. He's put $1 billion in additionally this year, adding to money that was already put in. And I announced some additional amounts of money. But those are to kickstart and get some things going. Those aren't sustained over a long period of time. We are working very hard on the Energy Transition Accelerator, which is a voluntary carbon market mechanism that would be only credited if you reduce a coal-fired or otherwise fossil fuel-fired plant and transition to renewables. In addition, we put together an energy conference last fall, which in the matter of 6 weeks, we produced $60 billion in commitments. And that is money that is real, that is going to be deployed. In addition, the president has put in the budget the 8.5 money that will add to the United States' commitment with respect to the $100 billion, and we anticipate that this year we should meet the $100 billion. That's a year ahead of what the pledge was. And the reason that's important is that President Biden only had an opportunity to affect the budget in the second year of his presidency. That's because of the reality that when someone's elected in November and sworn in January of the next year, the budget's already done. So for the first year, you're operating with the Trump budget, which had zero money in it for our climate. So everything President Biden is doing has to build on a zero base, and he's doing it, and we believe that'll get done. We're also working with philanthropies privately. We're working with the World Bank, and as you know, there was a change that was implemented at the World Bank with a new leader. The United States supported that with the belief that it could help us to accelerate the deployment of additional funds for lending. And to provide concessionary funding that will be the key to Africa being able to do some of these projects. But I think a place like Kenya, with the kind of announcements and leadership it's showing right now, will be able to attract a great deal of normal investment, this would be my take. And I've heard people chattering about that around here.
But I think Africa thinks that the global north is not doing enough. Do you think it's enough?
No, I don't think anybody's yet doing enough, to be honest with you. I think the world has too much business as usual right now. And we can show that in various places. I mean, we've had the disruption of Ukraine, which has had a profound impact on flow of capital and on available energy resources. We also had the fact that you had COVID, which just wreaked, you know, enormous havoc on the normal course of business and transition. So it's been an anomaly these last 2 years. And I think things are beginning to hopefully settle in a way that as we go forward, there will be a confidence about investing. I'll tell you this, in the next weeks, I believe you will be hearing news regarding demand for fossil fuel that is going to start to go down because of the rapid deployment of electric vehicles and the rapid deployment of renewables, which will have an effect on demand. And you can't come at this problem just from the supply side. You have to also deal with it from the demand side. Now, my sense is that, I mean, the United States, under President Biden's leadership, has put together one of the strongest commitments for 2030. And our commitment is Paris-aligned. The U.S. commitment is geared to try to keep 1.5 degrees alive. And if you look at the IEA judgments about what we're doing now with the IRA and with the deployment of renewables in the United States, 95% of our new energy in the United States is coming from renewables right now. So we're moving. And we're also seeing huge movement within batteries through the IRA is having an impact on investment in the United States already right now. And it will have an impact on the cost of these technologies when they're made available to other countries in the world, which they will be. So I think when you measure U.S. initiative here, you don't often see all we are doing. I know I'm taking a moment, but I'm going to be specific. We, at Glasgow, in the first year of having a special envoy for climate, which we've never had, that's a sign of the president's serious purpose, we created the First Movers Coalition. We now have over 80 companies. We started with 20-something. We have over 80 companies that have agreed they will buy a specific amount of green products, even though they're not being mass-produced and the price is higher. But they're doing it because they're showing leadership and stepping up as companies in the world to lead the pathway to a more rapid transition. That's something the United States started under President Biden's leadership. He announced it in Glasgow. We also, so we have companies like Maersk Shipping, Yara Shipping, MSC Shipping, which have all joined together and said, we're going to build ships that are carbon free. We're going to build ships that have new propulsion, and they're using methanol or other things. So that's a huge step forward. We also have aviation fuel beginning to be developed, sustainable aviation fuel, SAF. And we put together a coalition, including Salesforce, Apple, Boeing, United, Delta. They've all agreed that 5% of their Apple, their operations using airplanes, are going to use sustainable aviation fuel. So that's kicking it into gear. You have an agriculture initiative that we started with the UAE, which is the Agriculture Innovation Mission for Climate, which is now working on diet of livestock, different kinds of regenerative agriculture, all of which has profound impact on the marketplace. So I could go on. There are a lot of other initiatives. The shipping initiative on a global basis, the Green Corridor Initiative, so we have a green passage from port where the ship leaves all the way to its final port. Everything in between is going to be green. Those things are worth unbelievable amounts of money, and we're doing it on a voluntary basis with many of these companies. So I feel very positive about what the U.S. contribution is at this point in time.
Hi, Mr. Kerry. I'm Max Barak with the New York Times. I have two related questions. Of the $3 billion in adaptation funding that's been pledged, how much of that is subject to congressional approval? And if you could describe for us your process of lobbying Congress to make good on President Biden's $11.5 billion pledge, which, of course, is far from being met, just would be great to know.
Well, it's not accurate. As far from being the, are you talking about the $100 billion pledge, or are you talking about the $3 billion pledge?
Mm-hmm. I'm talking about the $3 billion. I want to
know. The $3 billion pledge depends on the Congress. Yes.
And of course, his 11.5 in climate aid pledge is also
that will be met. That will be fully met, I believe, by next year. And in this year, we're on track to do what he said he would do.
But if that's subject to congressional approval, then how much of that relies on you going to Congress and getting those votes?
Well, you know, the White House has a very experienced, capable team that has legislative liaison with the Congress. And I go up if I'm asked to, but I think there are a lot of other folks who are engaged in this endeavor besides me, whose job it is on a daily basis to be working on that particular track. So when called on, yes, I'll weigh in, and I certainly talk to friends of mine on the Hill. But I think that I think more and more people are becoming aware that this is about jobs. This is one of the biggest job-creating moments I have known in my lifetime. I served 28 years in the Senate, and you know, was a lieutenant governor and was a prosecutor, and I've seen government come and go and change. But I've never seen a moment where we're in a kind of transition that suddenly people are realizing is both necessary and real at the same time. So if you look at, I mean, if you look at something like how do you get a smart grid in place, which we're committed to doing? Well, you got to have transmission lines that go between states, and that has to be approved, needless to say. And you also have to have, but it all involves workers. Every aspect of what has to be done to meet the challenge of the climate crisis opens up job opportunities of one kind or another. Now, is there a transition in some companies? Yeah. But we've always been through transition. This transition is going to employ, for instance, if you got to lay new transmission lines, you will have almost every kind of worker involved. You're deploying solar panels or wind turbines. You know, you're going to have steel workers and aluminum workers and concrete and cement and, you know, electricians and plumbers and heavy equipment operators, and you run the list. There's work to be done to make this happen. In the United States of America, 2 years ago, the fastest growing job was wind turbine technician. The third fastest growing job was solar panel installer. So that just gives you an indicator of the reality of what this transition can produce.
Just to quickly re-ask the original question, the last budget included just $1 billion in international climate aid, and the president has said that he wants it to be 11. Do you think that that can happen by next year?
Personally, I believe it can, but obviously it depends a lot on what happens in Congress and in our politics. But let me be clear about this, that President Biden is convinced, and I share this conviction, no government can produce enough money to make sure this transition happens. No government, anywhere in the world. This transition is going to happen, in my judgment, because the private sector gets involved much greater degree than today, and the trillions of dollars that is looking for deals, for opportunity, is going to suddenly start to deploy. And it's going to start to deploy because in a lot of places, just as we've heard today, you're going to see governments deciding they need to create the framework within which the private sector can take the ball and run with it. And so, you know, you're going to have, it's happening now in a lot of places. It will happen a lot more. And nobody can reverse this. Can I say that? Sometimes I go somewhere and I'm asked, well, what happens if there's an election in the U.S. and you have somebody in there who doesn't like this? Well, guess what? While Donald Trump was president, 75% of the new electricity in the United States came from renewables. Even while he opposed to doing anything on that, was intervening. So in my judgment, this is a marketplace phenomenon now, where companies, CEOs around the world recognize this is the new economy of the future, the clean energy economy. And we're already seeing that acceleration have a major impact, and I think it's simply going to grow. And no politician will be able to step in. You think Ford Motor Company and General Motors and Mercedes and BMW and all these companies that have spent billions retooling their factories are suddenly go back and say, oh, whoops, well, that was good for them. We're going to go through it again and go back to the internal combustion engine. Not happening. And so, you know, I just think we need to be clear about the road we're on and embrace it.
Hi, this is Evelyn from the Associated Press. Just two questions quickly. On the West imposing its own aims for Africa, there's been several critics, especially on the during this upcoming summit. Can you point to us to a hard example where you and the U.S. have changed policies based on recommendations and ideas and policy things, direction that has been given from African leaders and African organizations? And then touch on the carbon taxes that the president of Kenya touched on, the need for that and how that could be implemented.
Well, let me give you an example of that change. And I personally experienced some of that change. When I began this job in 2020, I was appointed in 2021, I, you know, started work. Adaptation still had a second seat in the discussions. And within the time I got there and then the Glasgow meeting, we came to believe that adaptation deserved far more important attention, that it was a critical component of fairness and justice, and that we needed to help lead on that, and we did. We supported in Glasgow the doubling of the amount of money going to adaptation. We continue to support now adaptation as a critical component. Why? Why the shift? Because it is clear that as a result of the procrastination in moving forward and doing what should have been done, more and more damage and more injury is taking place to people in various parts of the world with the flooding, with the fires, with the drought, you know, all of that's having an impact, and you'd have to be pretty blind not to recognize a certain responsibility to do something about it. So President Biden, you know, has fully embraced. That's why he put the PREPARE program together. It is a recognition of that shift, if you will, in focus. With respect to tax and fee, the president and the administration have not yet embraced any particular carbon pricing mechanism. But the president has directed us to examine those that are the most prominent, that are the most possible, and to think hard about what the arguments are for and against and begin to work on it. I personally, this is not an administration position. I have personally supported the idea for a number of years. Quite a few, as a matter of fact, that one of the most significant, best ways of moving forward is precisely what President Ruto said, which is pricing carbon. Now, there are different ways to do it. And I was listening very carefully and working with the late Secretary of State and Secretary of Treasury, George Shultz, a Republican and a conservative who was extremely supportive of the pricing, as well as Secretary Jim Baker, who is down in Texas now, and I may see him in the next weeks. And he was out front in promoting this idea with Republicans. And there are a number of Republican senators now who have come to embrace this concept. So it's possible there could be a shift as we go forward. It hasn't happened yet. It's not administration policy, I repeat, but every expert will tell you it is probably one of the most effective ways that you could have an impact.
Thank you. Hi there, it's Kelly McNamara from AFP. We were talking yesterday to the IEA chief, and he expressed some concerns that geopolitical tensions were, you know, standing in the way of progress on the clean energy transition, and made a specific call for the US and China to kind of try and come together at COP28. I wondered if you could respond to that and maybe talk a little bit about what the U.S. is doing in terms of China and how that relationship might progress this year.
Well, I can't give you any prediction as to how it may progress. We were suspended in our conversations for a period of time last year because of the Taiwan issue. We, after the trip I made to Beijing, a month and a half ago or so, weeks ago, We had an agreement to continue now our dialogue, which we are doing. We've had a couple of virtual meetings. You know, China is complicated in the sense that it is building and deploying more renewables than all the rest of the world put together. But at the same time, it is emitting a massive amount of emissions from coal-fired power, and it's building new coal-fired power plants. And we've raised that with them. We obviously talk with them about that. We are looking for places where it might be appropriate to be able to cooperate, but we're not, it's not cooperation at any price. It's cooperation that comes because there's a reason to be able to cooperate in ways that we can have an impact on things together, which is what President Xi and President Biden originally agreed to do when they had a conversation after President Biden first came in. So our hope is that climate will be recognized for what it is. It is not a bilateral. It is not a, you know, mere grievance issue between the United States and China, as there are others, obviously, and a great many of them. It is a universal threat to the planet. Every country is impacted, including China, which experienced 52-degree temperatures this summer, which had massive flooding, and which has a citizenry that wants clean air and clean water and you know, to embrace what President Xi and other leaders often refer to as China's very deep commitment to the planet and to the environment. So we're looking for cooperation on those things, and we'll see whether or not it's possible to put something together. But I have no prediction of anything at this moment in time. I do hope that China and the United States, the two largest economies in the world, the two largest emitters in the world, I hope we could come together, because I think it would be an important, providing it's substantive, and we're going to agree to do some things, I think it would be very important to other workings of the COP and to the prospects for winning this battle, which we need to do.
Helen Shikanda from the Nation Media Group. Sometime in July at a congressional meeting, you say that under no circumstances will the U.S. pay climate reparations. But I feel like loss and damage is a form of climate reparations. So what exactly did you mean by that? And does it mean that should the loss and damage fund or the facility be approved at COP28 or the future COPs, will the U.S. be part of it?
Well, the United States and many nations in the world, many nations, this is not a unique position to us, have said that you know, we're not going to create some liability or compensation structure under court of law that you know, would change the dynamics of everything we're doing in a very negative way. So we're not going to do that. And that's all I was saying, is that it's what, you know, depends on what you're establishing this as. We believe, however, that there are losses and there are damages, and that it's an important thing for responsible nations to try to help countries that have been impacted by something that nobody really realized was creating all this damage for years, probably until 1988, when Jim Hansen first testified to Congress. And since then, we in the United States and a lot of other countries have taken enormous steps to respond to that reality. But, you know, Mother Nature doesn't choose between, you know, one country's emissions or another country's emissions. What affects Mother Nature are the total emissions that are up in the atmosphere. And so if they're going up when they ought to be going down, we all have a problem. And that's where we are today. They're going up. So as far as you know, the creating a civil liability or something, no, we are opposed to that, as are many other nations, as I said. But what we also support is getting the loss and damage fund pulled together. And also, we want to help countries that we know have been negatively impacted. When the flood took place in Pakistan that affected 30 million people. The United States stepped up the next day and put $100 million on the table to help, deal with it. And what we weren't asked, but we did it. And we are proudly the largest humanitarian donor country in the world. When you look at all the things we do, whether it's vaccines or AIDS or Ebola or, emergency rescue and other kinds of things. So I think the American people have been incredibly committed and generous, and through the years, they have recognized that kind of responsibility. But it's not something that should be punitive. It's something that should be cooperative, and that's what we're working at.
Thank you.
A couple more questions. Two more questions.
Well, my name is Matilda. I'm from the Standard Group in Kenya.
So you're from what? I'm sorry, Matilda. What group?
The Standard Group.
Oh, Standard Group. Okay.
Yes. So how does United States plan to address potential conflict between its economic interests, such as oil and gas export, and its climate commitments, especially in relation to African nations?
Well, let me be clear on behalf of the president, who has made it clear. We are the largest oil and gas producer in the world. But President Biden has set a very clear goal of getting to 50% transition of the clean power by 2030, and by 2035, wanting to achieve a carbon-free power sector. So we're obviously going to be reducing demand for our product we produce. And the reason we're doing it is that we think it's important to respond to the climate crisis. Now, one of the things that's been supported in the IRA, the Inflation Reduction Act, is carbon capture, utilization, and storage. And one of the things a lot of people don't necessarily pay attention to is that as you go forward towards 2050, we're going to have to continue to reduce. And even if you get to net zero 2050, you still have to be able to capture carbon. That's a scientific reality because of what's already up there and what we're putting up there every day right now. And so we're going to need to know how to do some carbon capture that has the ability to meet the net zero 2050 target. And the president is committed to working at that as we meet our goals going forward for 2030 and then 2050. Our 2030 goal, a lot of people forget, this doesn't have to be done by tomorrow. Be better if it could be, but it doesn't have to be, and that's not the course most people are on. We have a 2030 target. That target is based on science. And the science says, in order to avoid the worst consequences of the climate crisis, this is in the 2018 IPCC report, to avoid the worst consequences of the crisis, you need at least a 45% reduction in emissions between now and 2030. Our target is 50 to 52% reduction by 2030, and we believe we'll meet that target. But then you have to continue down. And the challenge for some of these companies is going to be, can you adequately capture those emissions at a scale and at a price which is competitive and functional, efficient, and so that you can continue on your Paris curve downwards in emissions? That will be the challenge for any energy company in the world. And obviously, we're determined to try to meet that challenge. So thank you all very much. I appreciate your interest. Glad to be here with you. I'm sure we'll see some of you in New York. And